Now that I have shown the codes, I will go to the unit testing part. So for this basic piece of code that I have explained in a previous video, I will show you how unit testing works on this. I guess you're already familiar with unit testing. If it's not the case, well, this is the right moment to start using it. I have used JUnit 5, the latest version of JUnit, for writing the tests for this code, because it has a number of more interesting features than the JUnit 4 unit tests. Let me first maybe just run all the unit tests on the code. I'm running all my tests, everything succeeds. So let me just go inside one particular test. A simple one is for testing the my number class. If we want to write unit tests in JUnit 5, we will have to import the things that are specific to JUnit 5. You don't have to remember this. I have already a lot of tests here, so you can just clone the GitHub repository and use the tests that I have already here and extend them. Maybe a difference with JUnit 4 is that instead of the before annotation, we have to use the before each annotation. So here for testing my number, I will always set up before every test, I will create a new number with value 8. My first test is to verify if two numbers are equal. So in this case, if I create a number, my number, with value 8, and I want to compare this with another number that has been created, so it's a different object, but it contains the same value 8, then I hope that these two values will be equal. On the other hand, if I create another number, 7, for example, and I compare this to my number, then I assume, I hope that these values will be different, because 7 is not the same as 8. I think I can directly run the test here to see if it works, and indeed it works. Just to show you, I will change the value here to something that will be incorrect, and if I then run the test again, there should be a failure indeed, because I changed here something, I have an assertion failed error, because the assertion is no longer true. I realize that maybe for testing equality, there is still another test that is missing, so I can add it. Maybe it's also useful to verify if two different objects that I want to compare are not the same. For example, suppose I want to compare a number to another type of object, maybe another expression, times okay, so I have added a third assertion here to have all of the different cases for testing equality. Equality of two numbers that are supposed to be identical if they contain the same value, two numbers that are not identical if they contain a different value, and verifying if a number is not the same as something else which is not a number. The reason why I had put here a try-catch statement, that's because the constructor method for all my operations, like times, is always throwing an illegal construction if we try to create something with an empty, with a parameter that is null. So that's the reason for this exception. For I can maybe continue showing a test compute. If I have a number, I can verify if the value contained in this number, in this case, the number has been created with value 8, should be the same as taking the number, computing the result of evaluating the expression, and returning the value of the evaluated expression. The depth of any number is 0, so if we count the depth of a number, it should be always 0. The number of operations contained in a number is always 0, so if we compare this, it should be 0. The number of values contained in a number is 1, so this would be 1. And if we convert a number to a string, then this string should contain exactly that number. So if we convert the value contained in the number to a string, then it should be the same as the conversion of the number to a string. So these are the typical tests, and tests I can run all of these together. The same types of tests will also be available for the other operations. So for example, if I want to run test device, I will get the same number of same operations, but there is many more operations that I've added as well. Here, for example, something that's different compared to JUnit 4 is how to test exception handling. So I mentioned before that we cannot create expressions where the argument, the parameter list is null. So if we would do this, then the constructor will throw an illegal construction. For example, if I take my divides constructor, I look at class divides, it throws an illegal argument, illegal construction. When does it do this? Because this constructor is inherited from the operation class. So if I look in the operation class, here we see it throws an illegal construction when the argument list that's provided, so the list of expressions that's provided as an argument, is null. So if we go back to the divides test, we know that if we tried to construct a new operation of type divides with null as a parameter, that it will give rise to an illegal construction exception. So to test this, we can actually use a newest type of assertion, assert throws, where the first argument is the exception that will be thrown. And here we write a function that takes the code that is being executed, which is the creation of the divides object. And during this creation, this illegal construction exception should be thrown. If it's thrown, the assert throws will be true. So if I run this, I just get true. The test is okay. If just to show you what happens, if I would simply write the constructor outside, okay, then I get an exception error because the exception is not caught or thrown. It's actually an error in the code. So to do it properly, I would need to surround this by a try catch and catch the error here. And then I could, for example, do something like fail. And if then I run this test again, then I see that the test gives rise to a failure. So because of this illegal construction problem, whenever we create new instances of the basic operations like divides, it's always within a try-catch statement, and the assertion will always be defined in inside the try statement. And if the assertion is not true, or if the divides construction gives an error, we go to the catch part, and there, because I don't want the test to succeed there, I explicitly instruct the test to fail. So that's what will be happening in most of the cases. So like this, there is lots of tests that have been written. Here there are some tests to show you if the notation, the infix, prefix, and postfix notation works properly. And with this, I think this has shown you an overview of the different types of unit tests. Perhaps in addition to this, one thing you will notice is that for all of these unit tests, so I can run them individually at the class level or at the single method level, or I can run them all together. I can also run them with coverage. That's what I just did here. So if you can see here, run tests with coverage. In fact, the IntelliJ Ultimate Edition, which is the one that I have installed here, allow you to run code coverage and test coverage for all your unit tests. It's one of the built-in features of the IntelliJ Ultimate Edition. And when you do this, then here we can see the results of test coverage. Basically, what this means is that all of the it will check to which extent the code that has been fully tested by the tests. So, is there any proportions of the code that have not been tested? You can see the results by the percentages being mentioned here. How many of the methods have been tested and how many of the lines of code have been covered? And we see that we have a really huge amount of class coverage, method coverage, line coverage. This is at the package level. We can go at the class level. The plus operation has been tested completely for every single line of code in the plus operation. There are tests. This is signaled by the 100% here or by the green bars here. So basically, this entire code has been run at least once by at least one test. Some parts are not tested. So here we have a slightly lower coverage. One method has not been tested. So let me just see which one is this. If I go to the my number class, okay, apparently, okay, it's a hash code function that has not been tested, and indeed it's correct. I actually never used this code somewhere, and I have never tested this code before. I also see that it's not only one method that has not been tested, but also some parts of a method have not been tested. So here, for example, the red parts are lines that have not been tested, so we could still complete our tests to increase our test coverage. The calculator class also has 33% of test coverage, so okay, the eval expression, the eval operation, the eval method has been tested, but the print and print expression details methods have not been tested. So this is a useful thing, analyzing test coverage to see to which amount didn't you forget to write tests for crucial parts of your code. So here I've shown you how to run test coverage directly with the built-in feature from IntelliJ, which you can directly get access to from the run feature with run tests with coverage. However, the POM file that I have provided for running this code with Maven also provides support for test coverage. So you can also do this from outside of the IntelliJ environment if you really want. So here we see that we use the Jacoco plugin, which is a Maven plugin. Jacoco is actually a tool in Java for code coverage and for test coverage. And so we have added it to the POM file to make it possible to generate code coverage from directly from Maven. So I will also show you how this works. I will still do it from within the IntelliJ environment since I'm still there. So if I go to the Jacoco plugin, I can generate a test coverage report by doing Jacoco report. In that case, what it will be doing is it will generate the report somewhere in the target folder, the place in the code where the test's coverage has been generated will be in the site, and then under Jacoco, here we see some HTML files that show you the results of all tests. So this is HTML files. So rather than opening them here in my IntelliJ environment, I will do it in a separate browser. Just do a drag and drop. If it works. Okay. So here now I'm in the browser. I've taken the generated HTML files. And here again, we see code coverage. This is another code coverage tool or test coverage tool that has been used. So here we see, if I take the calculator example, I see the percent of code that has been tested. So here are all of the classes, all of the Java classes that have been tested. And normally it should produce the same results as the previous tool. Maybe the calculations are quite or slightly different. So if we go to the MyNumber class, we see that all code has been tested except the hashCode method, as we have seen before. Here we see which parts have not been tested. They are indicated in red. For example, operation.java, there is here some part of the constructor that has not been tested, namely a constructor to check for null. And there is also the default case that has not been tested for toString. That's in fact expected because this case should never occur, so it's okay that it doesn't occur. Okay, so that's basically the code coverage. So we can do this in two different ways from within Eclipse, either using the built-in tool from Eclipse or using the Maven plugin Jacoco. Since it's a Maven plugin, this means that I can also directly run the code coverage from the command line. So if I go on the command line, then if I do this, mvn jacoco report, it will take the jacoco plugin and it will report all code coverage. And then I can go to the target folder in the site directory under jacoco, and there I can open the website with all results of the test coverage.